should we get started,
Let's
David?
Do that.
It's about 7:05. I think these people are waiting to say hello. Hi there. Hi there. Are we?
Sure.
Great. That's great.
Good. So happy to do this.
Yeah, me too. Me too. We'll have a party afterwards.
Oh my gosh, yeah, we will.
Wherever that is.
We may want to bring them on Mark Hankey or who.
Testing, testing.
Yes, indeed.
Yeah.
You good?
Good, yeah.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Cathedral of St. John the Divine. I'm Kent Tritle, the music director, and we're having a live event tonight. Hooray! I'm still pinching myself after last night's rehearsal. It just all feels so illegal in a way, but you know, we're doing it. And especially live with us tonight is this master, David Briggs. Certainly one of the great, great pleasures for me in my tenure here at the Cathedral, which is actually 10 years now, has been the coming on of David as an artist in residence. The breadth of programming that this has allowed us to do with David, you, and then the fine people who support this residency has really brought an incredible dimension, which is what we're going to experience tonight. What do you have to say, David?
This is an amazing experience to be here this evening. The sort of culmination of an 18-month project, the Beethoven. I love this place, and perhaps more than the place, I love the people of St. John the Divine, in the way that Madge and I have been really brought in and made it so incredibly welcome over the last, amazingly, 5 years. How did that happen? It's very strange, as you get older, it seems that the time just accelerates. It's a very, very weird thing. But the last concert that I gave here with an audience was in March 2020 with the Brahms First Symphony and the Debussy L'Après-Midi d'un Faun. And pretty much immediately after that, COVID really hit terribly in this wonderful city. And we have some very close friends up in Ipswich, Massachusetts, where we used to live, up on the North Shore. And my wife said, look, why don't we go to Ipswich for, let's say, a couple of weeks while things get better? Mm. 5 months later, we came back to New York, whose heart had been bruised, but was still really completely intact. And of course, we've been back here since that time. But one of the very first things that happened when we arrived in Massachusetts is that Madge said, well, we both, of course, love Beethoven and Beethoven 9, all the Beethoven symphonies, and have for many years. She said, why don't you transcribe Beethoven 9, and then we can do it at Big John when things get better. So you should understand that I'm a little bit of an impulsive character, and half an hour later, I downloaded the orchestral score of Beethoven 9, the piano duet version, and the piano solo version. And the following day, I set to work with the first movement from the orchestral score. And then, as you go through, you make cross checks with the piano duet and the piano solo version. So the whole procedure of making the arrangement took about the same time as we were in Ipswich, which is about 4.5 months. So I'm there with my computer, Beethoven 9, Beethoven 9 for organ. Then comes the really interesting part, which is starting to learn it. Because most times that this piece is performed, it's played by about 85 or 90 people. And I have two hands and 2 feet, although since my second Moderna vaccine, as some of you might notice, I actually have 7 fingers on both hands. and when the, I have 3 nostrils, but you won't see that because of my mask. And And also, when things get really exciting, and you won't be able to see that because I'm facing that way, but my eyes go green and start rotating very fast. So the arrangement went through about 12 different edits. And how that works, and it seems to be pretty constant in all the transcriptions that I do, I move completely away from the orchestral score or from the recordings. And the intention always is to make it into an exciting and coherent organ piece. So you make a lot of changes with things like the fingering, the things like the voice leading, the way that the things feel on the keyboard is very important. Because if it's too difficult, there's not much point. Which is not to say that it's a caricature or that you lose things. I think in truth, and I'd be very interested to know what you think after the Beethoven tonight, the truth of the matter is that, sure, you lose some things when you have a transposition to the organ. But I think also, especially in here, you also gain a lot of things. Just wait till you hear the slow movement. It's just so moving in this space with this great acoustic. And in the scherzo, which, as you probably noticed, we have just behind the organ here, a wonderful, slightly solitary percussionist.
Ben, stand. Give a stand here. Ben Herman.
So you all know the scherzo of Beethoven 9. It starts, the full orchestra goes, bum ba bum, bum ba bum. Thank you. Bang on cue. And then the orchestra goes again, bum ba dum. So we just thought this is going to be quite a good razz to have a real percussion, a really loud timpani in the scherzo. Then we come to the Turkish march in the last movement of Beethoven 9, which is, I mean, this last movement is as long, actually, as many of the complete symphonies of Haydn or Mozart. It's like, in a sense, a choral fantasia, perhaps, or like a fully structured symphony in itself. Anyway, the second section is this fantastic ba-bum, ba-bum, ba-bee, ba-bum. Beethoven trying to be light-hearted for once. And so in the original, there's bass drum. Well, I can do that quite well on the organ with the 32-foot stops. And then there's also triangle and cymbal. So we thought what fun it would be to have a triangle and a cymbal. So I think when you hear it, it's a very nice color. But it's been a colossal project. And of course, we can't really know what Beethoven would think. What, in my research about the history of this piece, well, it was 1824 he wrote it. But you know, he was completely deaf by the time he was 22 years old. And at that time, he was one of the greatest pianists ever, and very renowned as a performer, an extrovert, a little bit of a maniac maybe, fantastic improviser. He brought up his family from a very young age. He had an alcoholic father and became mature, perhaps prematurely, than he would have done otherwise. And then he lost his hearing. And just to think that he composed all the symphonies from number 3, the Eroica, onwards, right until 1824, when he composed this gigantic masterpiece, that he lived with a kind of interior world. And of course, that's a terrible thing for Beethoven, and the way that his personality changed from being a vibrant extrovert to being a very intense, angry, musician and person. Goethe said that he was socially, I quote, completely impossible. But of course, that vibrant internal world, well, it gave us this, it gave us the Missus Solemnis, it gave us the last quartets, it gave us the last three piano sonatas. And so for us, of course, it's a marvelous, marvelous thing. But when he you can read in the program about when he conducted this piece for the first time in Vienna and lost his place and still conducted when the orchestra had finished. Well, actually, Kent Tritle is going to do that tonight because we're trying to be totally authentic. And it was first performed, by the way, in New York, well, in America, in 1844 by the New York Philharmonic. It was the first time this piece was ever sung in English, and it was conducted by a British violinist called George Fornham. He was then the concertmaster of the Philharmonic. And then since those days, of course, it's become well known all over the world by everybody, much, much loved. When the Berlin Wall came down in 1989, there was that amazing performance conducted by Mr. Bernstein, which I watched yesterday. Absolutely incredible performance. And so there it is, Beethoven 9. And this is, I believe, almost certainly the first time that it's been played as an organ piece.
Bravo, absolutely incredible. And let's talk about that a little bit. Many people are unaware now, less aware now than we were maybe 30 years ago when I arrived in New York. 40 years ago. Okay, there you go. But we were hearing the stories about the great tradition. At that point, Musica Sacra had started to do concerts, professional choral concerts in churches with orchestra. But the tradition had been very much that Vernon Dittar, a great teacher at Juilliard, who was down at Church of the Ascension, would do his annual performances of Honegger King David, with he playing the full score on the organ in transcription and conducting. One of the highlights in the 1980s for me was to go to the Church of St. Bart's, St. Bartholomew's Church, and hear Bill Trafka on the organ at St. Bart's with Jim Litton conducting Verdi Requiem. I've never heard the Verdi Requiem like I heard it that day, done on the organ. And of course, the incredible Virgil Fox at Riverside, we were also doing these things. And so it was actually a matter of course that on Sunday afternoons in New York, you could go and hear these great oratorios or requiems or masses in the way that you may hear the Beethoven 9 tonight. That fell out of fashion, and people fell out of practice in doing these things. And so I wonder, David, you now have made quite a mark in these transcriptions. How did you catch that unvaccinatable transcription bug?
Well, I suppose the first thing to say is that the history of playing transcriptions on the organ is really a very important part of the evolution of the instrument. The first person, I suppose, to make transcriptions of orchestral music, both his own music and others, was no less than Johann Sebastian Bach. And since then, transcriptions have always been really important. In this country and in the UK, particularly at the end of the 19th century, there were organists like W.T. Best in Liverpool, the great Edwin H. Lemaire, who was a Brit who settled in the US at the end of the 19th century. These were real, incredible virtuosos who could play anything on the organ. And so they kind of really nourished the idea of transcription concerts. So if you went to a concert, for instance, in the Alexandra Palace in London in, let's say, 1900, there was a fantastic four-manual Willis organ. The organist there rejoiced under the fabulous name of Dr. Reginald Goss Custard. They don't make them like that anymore, but he used to do these extraordinary concerts on Sunday afternoons with an audience of 4,000. And then he would play it again at 6 o'clock with another audience of 4,000. I mean, these were really the glory days of the concert organ. And then, of course, in this country, Virgil Fox came and got a lot more young people involved, fantastic technician, but also, as well as showman, absolutely amazing musician. And then, as Kent referred to 5 minutes ago, in about 1930 through till, let's say, the 1970s, there was a movement in organ playing and organ building, really, called the organ reform movement. And during those periods, if you played a transcription, people kind of laughed at you because you were being bad-mannered or low-class, and you could only play Bach or music that was written before Bach or music that was written after 1950. And then in the last 30 or 40 years, I think it's been very refreshing to see the pendulum come a little bit more into the middle, whereby, of course, we've learnt so much from the Bach organs themselves via CDs and YouTube and Facebook and so on. We know actually what the organs that Bach heard really sound like. We know a lot more about the way Bach fingered music and the way that orchestral players played with the shorter bows and the gut strings and so on. So we've really learnt a huge amount from the period instrument tradition. But I think now is the time to bring the pendulum more into the middle and to bring the organ into playing wonderful music for the general music public and not just people who are only interested in organ music, which is why I love to play Beethoven on the organ.
I think it's fantastic. One of the great things that's also gone on in organ playing and organ interest in the last 20 years, in my experience, is a huge resurgence of interest in improvisation at the organ. It's always been important for the church service to have improvisation at the right time, not too little, not too loud, just whatever was needed. Some people called it noodling. You could just go in circles, you know? But the tradition of improvisation, which goes back to the French Romantics, and of course, J.S. Bach himself was attributed in his obituary as one of the great improvisers. He could improvise a five-voice fugue. That art now is so much more alive and well, I believe, in our 21st century culture. And David, where I'm going with this is that you, along with Olivier Latrie at Notre Dame, are one of the world's finest improvisers. It's true. He's known for this. I think you all know, right? Yes. So the thing that interests me, and back to the discussion, and by the way, when he says about the Beethoven transcription that it shouldn't be too difficult, oh, please. You know, but because you are out of the box as an improviser, how does that affect your making of transcriptions? I feel like you're coming at it, you came first from the inside, looking through the piano scores, through the vocal scores, but then you have the orchestra score, but then you come at this as a person who improvises. Mm-hmm. How does that impact your work?
Well, I think, I mean, you mentioned Bach. My own theory with Bach is that what's on the written page was just the beginning of the story when he played.
Yes.
I mean, you listen to all the recordings of Bach. Get it?
Don't we wish?
Wouldn't that be something nice? What would he think about New York City in 2021? The answer is he would absolutely love the electricity of this great city.
Oh, I do think so.
Yeah, I think
absolutely.
So. But I think when Bach performed, undoubtedly he embellished a lot. We know, I mean, Beethoven, you know, all these wonderful piano sonatas. My hunch is that he could improvise those without thinking twice. You know, those are just like written down but polished up improvisations. So I think really, I mean, but conceptually, this art of improvisation, transcriptions, it's all to do with lifting the music off the surface of the page, doing something that is effective in its new guise to sort of recast the original material. So inevitably, in every bar, you're imagining this small figure with huge amounts of rather disheveled hair before the days of deodorant, and was also rather deaf and a little bit grumpy and liked his brandy. I think we would have probably got on rather well, actually. But you're trying to internalize what he would say if he was here, listening to it in St. John the Divine, played with this with these resources.
Well, David, thank you. Thank you, thank you for making this possible. Ladies and gentlemen, David has a concert to play, so we probably will bid you farewell for the moment. David, thank you.
My pleasure. Bravo. Thanks for coming.
Gathered here tonight in celebration of a variety of things. The first thing is that we are gradually reopening the cathedral, as you can well see for yourself. And I can't tell you how it makes me so glad and joyful to see this cathedral doing what it's designed to do. To host, to welcome, to include, and to celebrate. So welcome, welcome, whoever you are, wherever you're from. You're welcome in this place always. This is God's house. Every one of us here and everybody on this planet is made in God's image. So this is our house. But I wondered earlier today, What is the lifeblood of this cathedral? What makes it alive? Well, certainly one thing is the grace and goodness of God, who has blessed this place with a ministry of welcome and inclusion. And it flows through this place. But there's another thing. And worship of God is certainly part of the lifeblood here. The second part of the lifeblood is music. Music is like blood flowing through the body. It brings air and light and life. So finally, together, we're celebrating the return to life of the cathedral. It's like taking a deep breath when you're waking up. Thinking about music. When I was in college, I took a music course, and part of that course was an introduction to the three great B's of music. You all know as well as I do who they are, right? You might want to name one of the B's. Bach, Beethoven, Brahms. I'm going to add a fourth B tonight, and that B is going to be Briggs. There you are. What a monumental task to transcribe the whole of the Ninth Symphony to the organ. God bless you, and thank you. And behind David and this great music and this genius we're about to hear, there stands another person who was the inspiration and the architect of the music program here at St. John the Divine. That's Kent Tritle. Where is Kent? Okay, he's hiding over there somewhere. But with thanks to Kent and the choir, oh, there you are. I knew you were hiding. And with thanks to David and to Kent and to the choir and the staff of this place, it is a joy and a pleasure to say welcome to this cathedral and enjoy this concert.
Thank you.